Thank you. Thank you for your good singing.
Come.
Himself ordained this holy sacrament, and he commanded his disciples to partake of the bread and the wine, these emblems of his broken body and of his shed blood. This is his table. The feast is for all of his disciples. And let all those who have with true repentance forsaken of their sins and believed in Christ and the salvation, draw near today to take these elements, and by faith you partake of the life of Jesus Christ to your soul's comfort and joy. We remember that it is the memorial of the death and the passion of our Lord, also a token of his coming again. We are one at one table with the Lord. Please take the bread and remember that on the night that our Lord was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks for it, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body that was given for you. Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you." Likewise, after the supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ shed for you preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Pray with me, please. Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to receive these elements, the bread, the cup, and to be reminded of the great price that was paid for our salvation. We thank you, Lord, for your incredible love. We thank you, Lord, that you love us like no other could. Father, we just thank you. We bless your name. Jesus, you were obedient even to the point of death. Death on the cross, that we might be forgiven and have a home in heaven. Lord, I just pray today that each one in this place and those who are worshiping with us today online would sense anew your wonderful presence, would sense again your love for each and every one of us today, Jesus. Father, there are so many of our church family that has special needs today of sickness, direction, Lord, that they need, provision. You know every need today. And we pray that you would go to each one and touch them in a special way. Father, I pray that you would answer the prayers and the petitions of each heart and each life as they cast their cares upon you today, because you care for them. Jesus, we love you. We bless your precious name, the lovely name of Jesus. And your disciples said, Lord, teach us to pray. They sincerely wanted to know how to communicate with God. And you said to them, and when you pray, say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And then, if you would, let's again together read the Apostles' Creed and affirm our faith today. Because I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades, and the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Church universal, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Well, it's good to look out here today and see you and know that we have many that are worshiping with us online as well today. And we welcome them in this service and many that will view it on YouTube later on today and throughout the week. And our presence is literally going worldwide. We are in many countries of people that contact us and tell us that they're watching our services. And so we thank the Lord for this avenue and how the Lord is blessing. And we welcome each and every one of them. Also, as we think about this morning coming back, well, it's nice to have Christy back, but she didn't just come back by herself. She went and then she came back with a little gift. And Luke, would you help me today? And will you just go and take Alec? And this is our newest little Nazarene, Alec Grimes, and his first day in church today. And isn't it a good thing he chose Southeast Church of the Nazarene to go to church on his first day? And so Luke is going to walk around and show you little Alec. Holding him up like a trophy. Yeah. Isn't he something?
He already has his overalls on.
He's got his overalls on and his hand up, bless the Lord. Now look at the camera down there too. There you go. Amen. Let's give them another big hand. Praise the Lord. How fun. So we had planned to honor Nancy Kaiser. And we're glad Nancy and Cindy's here today, and it's a blessing to see them. And I have two certificates today from the NMI, our local NMI, Brother Bob Goins and the council, voted unanimously to present Nancy with this plaque that says, "Presented to Nancy Kaiser for your extraordinary and faithful service as president of NMI. We honor you with the title of President Emeritus of Southeast Church of the Nazarene, May 9, 2021. And then we also have the ability now, she was not able to be here last week, but we have Rex's Memorial Roll Certificate also to present to Nancy. Let's give Nancy a big hand.
Thank you.
thank you. We're going to ask the ushers if they would to come and wait upon us this morning to receive the Lord's tithes and our offerings. As our ushers are coming, I want to thank you for your faithfulness in giving to support the Lord's work through the ministries of Southeast Church of the Nazarene. And you are a wonderful and a generous people, and God is blessing and working through your giving. And Brother Clyde, would you pray for us, please?
Father, we are grateful for your blessings, for your goodness, for you being in our service.
Yes.
We want to lift you up, Lord, and give you praise above all in our lives. We're thankful for all that you have done, how you have blessed the church. We pray that you'll bless this offering. All these things we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus paid it all.
Amen.
All to him I owe. Praise his name. If you would, take your Bibles with me and let's look together this morning at 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, we'll begin to read at verse 13. Going to be reading it from the original Greek. Translated to English. Translated again to the New Living Translation. Verse 13, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. But we continue to preach because we have the same kind of faith the psalmist had when he said, I believed in God, and so I speak. We know that the same God who raised our Lord Jesus will also raise us with Jesus and present us to himself along with you, All of these things are for your benefit. And as God's grace brings more and more people to Christ, there will be great thanksgiving and God will receive more and more glory. That is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. For our present troubles are quite small and won't last very long. Yet they produce for us an immeasurably great glory that will last forever. So we don't look at the troubles we can see right now. Rather, we look forward to what we have not yet seen. For the troubles we see will soon be over, but the joys to come will last forever. For we know that when this earthly tent we live in is taken down when we die and leave these bodies, we will have a home in heaven, an eternal body made for us by God Himself and not by human hands. We grow weary in these present bodies, and we long for the day when we will put on our heavenly bodies like new clothing. For we will not be spirits without bodies, but we will put on new heavenly bodies. Our dying bodies make us groan and sigh. But it's not that we want to die and have no bodies at all. We want to slip into our new bodies, so that these dying bodies will be swallowed up by everlasting life. God Himself has prepared us for this, and as a guarantee, He has given us His Holy Spirit. Now think about over your childhood years and on into your preteen and for those of you who are adults, you think about later on in life. What in all of your lifetime, the best you can remember and look back to, what was your favorite toy of all of your lifetime? Think about that toy. Every Christmas, toy companies, they push out their latest and their greatest toy. Most of those toys, you know, they come and they go and they only seem to be a short-lived fad. They might sell one year, but then they disappear and you never see those toys again. But some toys, they remain popular and even they become a collector's item for some people. Journalist Allie Townsend published an article in Time magazine on the 100 most influential toys from the 1920s to the 2000s. So let me read you all 100 toys. How about I just give you a couple of them? And everybody said, oh, thank the Lord. Anybody remember the radio flyer wagon? It was the most popular when Robert Brown was born in 1920. Wally's got one. 1920 version. So that was the most popular toy that came out in 1920s. Etch-a-sketch, remember those? Slip and slide. They came to us in the 1960s and even beyond. The 1970s, they brought us toys like the Nerf ball. What would we do without a Nerf ball? And the Weebles. You remember the Weebles? Huh? The wobbling Weebles. We wobble, but we what? Oh, hang on to that. And the Paddington Bear. 1980s. Cabbage Patch Kids.
Yeah.
Everybody likes Cabbage Patch Kids, right?
Got one.
Everybody want to go play at Wally's house. The 1990s brought us the Super Soaker Water Gun. Wally's got one. And the 2000s, They brought us the Bratz dolls, wouldn't you know it, in the 2000s? The MindFlex headset and the Zuzu robotic hamsters. Wally's got those. You got them. You know, all these great toys, and it's hard for toy designers to know which one's going to last and which one's just going to fade on into oblivion. But I bet the inventor, we're going to go back now to the Weebles. I bet the inventor of the Weebles in those early days never expected that little egg-shaped doll would turn out to be as popular as it did. One reason they sold so well was because they had that catchy little song that you are humming in your heads right now. Weebles wobble, but they don't fall down, right? If you grew up in the 70s and you sang that song, you're going to probably have that humming in your head the rest of the day, and you're going to say that lousy preacher, and all I can say is you're welcome. But a few years ago, Pastor Brian Hunter, he wrote about his childhood love for those wobbling Weebles, and he said you could hit it, you could punch it, you could slam it on the ground, but regardless of how that Weeble was treated, guess what? It always bounced back up, right? And he said, I discovered that each Weeble had a small weight on the bottom, so when they were knocked down, the weight would pop them right back up into upright place. Now think about that. If only we humans were a little bit more like those Weebles. Weebles wobble, but they won't fall down. I hope that can be said of the people of God. We wobble sometimes, we're knocked down sometimes, we have adversity and reverses in our life. But may we be the people who, though we may be knocked down, we don't fall down, but we can bounce back up. You see, Paul, in his letter here of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, he writes to us very importantly these words, therefore we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we can be renewed day by day. Because Paul says our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory. You see, the setbacks, the problems, the adversities we have in life, they have a purpose. God has a purpose for those. And the Bible says that they are achieving for us an eternal glory that outweighs all of the light and momentary troubles that we endure. So he said, we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary. Now, when you're going through it, it doesn't seem like it's very temporary, does it? Sometimes those setbacks, those times when we're knocked off our feet or punched over like a Weeble, it seems like it's a long time in that journey, but when you compare that to eternity, it's short-lived. But what is unseen lasts for all of eternity. You see, Paul the Apostle, he knew what it was to have status and success, particularly in the religious community. And he also knew what it was to lose that status and lose success. He said, I've had plenty, and I've been in want. I know what it is to have. I know what it is to have not. You see, Paul knew that life has a tendency to hit us, to punch us, sometimes slam us to the ground. And when we try to make a significant change in our life, it just seems we maybe take one step forward and three steps back. But you've lived long enough to realize we're not Weebles. We're not guaranteed that we're going to bounce right back like that weevil does when we get knocked down. So we need help. And in this Bible passage, Paul shares with us the secret of strength and the resilience and even joy that we can face even in the midst of trials and of hardships and all the troubles of life. So first of all, Paul says to us, don't allow discouragement to defeat you when hardships and trials come your way. It's so easy to just get discouraged and disappointed and depressed, but we must not allow those tragedies and those troubles to defeat us, to discourage us. Paul says, we do not lose heart. Though our outward nature is wasting away, the inner man renewed day by the indwelling, the healing, the presence of Jesus Christ. And thanks be to God, as a guarantee, God gives us His Holy Spirit. So even though this outward nature is wasting away, and life does take its toll on us, amen. Dana's papa used to always say, thank God for hospitals. Thank God for sickness. He said, that's kind of weird. No, it's not. It's a man of faith. Because he said, if there was not sickness, if there were not troubles in this life, we would get to thinking this is heaven. But this is not heaven. We have something that's going to last for all of eternity in a place called heaven. So we do not lose heart. Somebody said, if no one knows the trouble you've seen, you've had a facelift. Think about it. Life takes its toll on us, does it not? Paul knew hardship. He knew troubles. And he knows what hardship can do to us. You may have heard about the former heavyweight boxer, James Quick Tillis. Tillis is a cowboy and an actor, and he was a former boxer. He grew up in Oklahoma, good country to grow up in. He fought, though, in Chicago in the early 1980s. He still remembers the first day that he arrived in Chicago, leaving from Tulsa, Oklahoma, and going to Chicago. He said, I got off the bus. He said, I had two cardboard suitcases under my arms, and he got to downtown Chicago, and he stopped in front of the Sears Tower. He said, I put my suitcases down, and I looked up at the skyline, and he said to myself, I am going to conquer Chicago. He had that much confidence. He said, I'm going to conquer Chicago. And then he looked down, and his suitcases were gone. We've all had days like that. Life is hard. Sometimes we get discouraged. But the secret to a successful life, as Paul tells us, is to not lose heart. Don't give up in the midst of troubles and setbacks and adversities. We are not promised an easy road in this life. Jesus said, in this world, you will have many troubles. Jesus told us right up front. So Paul is saying, hang in there, give God a chance, and don't give up. Don't throw in the towel. Hang on to what God has for you. David Langerfield in the Daily Encourager devotional, he suggests a mental exercise that we could use to help us in troublesome situations and times in our life. He says, suppose that I were to dump 10,000 plastic eggs in your backyard. And he said, and in those 10,000 eggs, I tell you that there's one of them with a $1 million check made out to you in one of those eggs. Not all, but one. He said, would you get discouraged after you opened 100 eggs and they were empty? He said, would you get discouraged after you opened 1,000 eggs and they were all empty? He said, of course you would not. You would just keep sitting there open those eggs because you know sooner or later you're going to find that $1 million check made out to you. Think about the Apostle Paul's life. He was beaten. He was stoned. He was imprisoned. He was shipwrecked. He starved. He was rejected. And yet through all of that, Paul says that his sufferings were nothing, nothing compared to the glory that awaits us in heaven. You see, that's why he could say, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are renewed day by day. Again, Papaw, greatest theologian, greatest Christian I've ever known to walk the earth. Papaw says, his eyesight was growing very dim. Hearing was almost gone. But he said, Brian, Dana always told him, I want to meet this guy, Brian. Brian, I can't see out there too good anymore. But he said, I'm seeing the old man inside of me better than I've ever seen the old man inside of me. And his spirit was renewed day by day. He kept the faith and kept strong and kept being encourager even at 105 years old. And the Lord called him home. You see, we don't give up. You might have to open a lot of those eggs in the backyard and they'd be empty. But sooner or later, you have the hope and the assurance that you're going to get to the right one. Let me tell you, there is a greater day coming than all the problems and all the troubles that you and I experience in this life. Amen. Amen. Terry Fox was a young Canadian athlete. He was diagnosed with osteosarcoma, a very aggressive bone cancer, at the age of 18. He had to have a leg amputated, and he would learn to live life with his prosthetic leg. Terry Fox set a goal at 18 that he would run across Canada and raise money for cancer research. He called it his marathon of hope. His dream was to raise $1 million for cancer research. On April the 12th, 1980, he set out from Newfoundland, an island at the easternmost edge of Canada, and every day he ran almost a complete marathon on a prosthetic leg, and something remarkable happened. The news of Terry Fox's marathon of hope, it united the citizens of Canada in a very amazing way. People across the country were cheering Terry Fox on, following his route and donating money to cancer research. Terry Fox made it 143 days before his body started to give out. Tragically, the cancer had then spread to his lungs, and Terry died on June 28, 1981, at the age of 22. He never made it to the westernmost side of Canada. But indeed, he met the goal. His goal was to raise $1 million. During that time, he raised $24.1 million for cancer research and united the citizens of Canada. Today, people across Canada and around the world still hold a Terry Fox run every year. and they have raised untold millions of dollars. You know what? That's why we say, don't lose hope. Don't give up. Though outwardly we're wasting away, Terry Fox's body wasted away, but by the grace of God, God used him to inspire an entire nation. Thanks be to God, we don't have to give up. We don't have to give in to our circumstances. We don't have to fall prey to the problems and the setbacks and lick our wounds and cry and bemoan and say, poor me, nobody's ever had it as bad as I have. Paul did. Worse than any of us ever have. Jesus did. And they never gave up. So we need to hold on and trust God's unseen hand and believe that He is going to carry us and sustain us and give us all we need to live victorious. Amen. Don't let discouragement defeat you. Why should I feel discouraged? His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watching you as well. Like my professor used to say, his eye's on the sparrow and he's watching you birds too. That brings us to the next step. Focus on the task at hand. Don't worry about what was, what could have been. Focus on what needs to be done now. Wise people learn to let go both of their regrets about the past and their anxieties about the future. Is there anything that you and I can change about the past? That's why it's called the past, right? Amen. Is there anything that you and I can do about tomorrow when tomorrow hadn't gotten here yet? So what do we deal with? We deal with now. Deal with the task at hand. Who knows what tomorrow's going to bring? Shut the door on the past. Trust God with the days ahead if He should give them to you. And let's make today a purposeful, meaningful day. Amen. A young Marine was interviewed, and this person interviewing the young Marine, she said to him, "Oh, it must have been so tough being over in the war and all these things, and also thinking about your family at home." And he said, "Oh, no, ma'am." He said, "We are never taught to think about what might be or could be." He said, "We are trained to be fully available right where we are right now." You know, that's a powerful life lesson for us. To be fully available right now where we are. How much more effective would you be if you practiced being fully available in the present? Not fretting over the past, not having anxieties about tomorrow, but trust God for today. The Lord's Prayer says, "Give us this day our daily bread." What do I need today to be successful living for Jesus? That's what Jesus wants to do for us, is meet the need today. Do we ever stop to consider how God works in the things that are unseen in our lives? If we'll learn to be fully available to God now, God will reveal things to us. He will open up doors for us. And just think about how God wants to work in your lives if you'll just be fully present today where He is. What do I need now, Lord? Give that to me now, Lord. I always say God doesn't give you dying grace till you're dying. People say, "Oh, I hope God give me grace." He'll give you grace when you need it. And He'll never be late with it. He'll never fail you. But He's not going to give you dying grace a minute before you need it. So don't worry about it. I'm doing a whole lot better job of preaching than you are saying amen. Y'all all right out there? The essential key is to trust. Trust your Heavenly Father. That's the key, folks, is to trust the Heavenly Father is watching you, knows where you are, knows the things that you have need of. I love the story that comes out of the 1960s, a young British woman named Jackie Pullinger. Jackie Pullinger believed that God had called her to Hong Kong to be a missionary. However, the problem was no missionary society would partner with her. In her best-selling book, Chasing the Dragon, she shares some very extraordinary advice that she received from a local vicar at a church. And I want you to listen closely to this advice that was given to her. He told her, he said, young lady, if you had a job and you had a ticket and you had accommodations, a sick fund and a pension fund, you would not need God. There would be no need for you to trust God because it's all laid out before you. He said, if I were you, I would go out and buy a ticket to a boat that's going on the longest journey you can find. And he said, if I were you, I would pray every day asking God to tell you when it's time to get off. Now that's trust. That's big time trust. You just get on board and you just wait till God tells you to get off. I don't know too many people that trust God quite that much. But she did. She trusted God. And she prayed. And she asked God, God, when do I get off of this boat? He said to her, young lady, you cannot lose if you will put yourself completely in God's hands. Now, wouldn't that be great if that were true? You cannot lose if you will put yourself fully into the hands of Almighty God. Well, the truth is, it is true. With no idea what she was getting into, Jackie Pullinger followed the advice of this vicar. She boarded a slow boat to China. And every day she prayed and prayed and prayed for God's guidance. And finally the day came that God directed Jackie to the infamous walled city of Kowloon, a slum area filled with criminal gangs, drugs, prostitution, and desperate poverty. Jackie had about $10 in her pocket. She had no connections. She knew nobody there. She had no support coming from home. But what she had was trust in God. That's all she had, and that's all she needed. And God put her in Kowloon to bring a message of hope about Jesus. So she began to go to work. And she would reach out to gang members and drug addicts and prostitutes. And her faithfulness and hard work produced an amazing harvest. For since landing in Hong Kong in 1966, Jackie Pullinger has brought thousands of people, drug addicts, criminals, prostitutes, to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. No one can imagine the lives that have been changed and that continue to be changed by the testimonies of those whose lives were changed. That's why Paul says, folks, don't lose heart. Don't give up. Though outwardly we're wasting away, we're getting older every day. We're changing every day. We're getting closer to heaven every day. Amen. Outwardly, we're wasting away. But inwardly, we can be as strong and as resilient and as full of hope and full of faith if we will trust in God and believe that God is more than able to meet every one of life's needs. So we must not worry about all these burdens of life, though we may be knocked down, though we may be even smashed to the ground, though we experience setbacks. Believers in Jesus, they don't give up. They don't lose heart. Like weebles, we may wobble, but because of Christ, we don't have to fall down. Amen. There is no burden too big what God cannot help you carry it. There is no valley too deep and dark that God will not walk with you. He didn't say you're not going to go to the valley of the shadow of death. You're going to go through it. In this world, you're going to have much troubles and tribulation. But he said, be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. Amen. So nowhere will you go that God's grace and God's presence and God's strength will be right there with you. Amen. Don't lose heart. Even though life takes its toll on the outer person, the inner person can still be strong. What is this, third or fourth time I've talked about Papaw today? He must be on my mind. At 105, he's still thinking up ways to tell people how much Jesus loves them. And until his eyesight just got so bad that he was really having a lot of problems and had to quit going out to the woodshed, he was out there carving things, and everything he ever carved, and every candlestick, and every lamp, and every little walking stick and stool, and everything that he built, he always wrote on the bottom of it, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." And he said, "I don't sell anything. If somebody wants to give me a little money for lumber, that's fine, but I don't need it." He said, "But they don't get anything without me giving them a sermonette." And he would talk about where that wood came from. God created that, and God created you, and God shook this and takes it and uses it, and God can do that to you too. And 105, could hardly get around. Couldn't hear anything in church, but he still said in church. Why? You're wasting your time. He said, "I'd rather be in the presence of the Lord and with God's people than sitting in an old folks' home." Amen. So don't let discouragement defeat you, church. Focus on the tasks at hand and trust your Heavenly Father. He cares for you. He knows what you need. Do these things, and you will be inwardly renewed day by day until that day that you see God face to face. So though outwardly we're wasting away, be renewed on the inside. Be young at heart spiritually, alive, vibrant, up to date, fresh in your witness and testimony to tell others about the good news of Jesus. Would you pray with me? Father God, we thank you today that our hopes and our trust is not in this world and the things of this world, but our hope and our trust is in Jesus, who has promised to never leave us nor forsake us. And Lord, we bless your great and awesome name. We thank you, God, that you are worthy of trust. We can trust you. We can put all of our hope in you. For our help comes from the Lord. Our help does not come from the hills, Our help comes from the Lord of the hills, maker of heaven and earth. Lord, I pray that you would strengthen us, remind us, make us strong Christians on the inside so that we don't give up, so that we don't lose heart, but we'll trust you each and every day. And we pray these things in your name, the name of Jesus. And all of God's people said, amen. Let's stand together and sing, "Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus."
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to
church.